You might not have that luxury with the Chetak. And the reason why I say that is because, Rajiv, if I understand the industry correctly, and please correct me if I'm wrong, the shift to electric vehicles is going to be one of the biggest metamorphoses or transformations that this industry has seen, because it's going to impact everything from technology to manufacturing to the way you sell and communicate to consumers. And at this stage, the Chetak seems to be in very infant stages of that. Chetak is your bet on the future, but it still looks like a very small tentative bet. It's like you're feeling your way through that market. Is that correct to say?
I wouldn't say so, because the Chetak is certainly our first move in that direction. And, you know, like the Pulsar 20 years ago, I said then that it will start slow, but it will open up Bajaj 2.0, and which it did over time. And I think Bajaj 3.0 can ride in on the back of Chetak. Quantitatively, we are again making just a few hundred a month, but that is not, unlike in the case of Cube, that is not for want of demand. I mean, the marketing guys want 5,000 a month yesterday. But as you said, because the supply chain is very disrupted, particularly with semiconductors and stuff. So it will take us a little while to get there, and then we can roll it out across the top 30 cities in the country. Qualitatively, we are in a very good space, because I have seen many reports comparing the Chetak with other similar vehicles in the marketplace and suggesting that it is head and shoulders above everything else. So I think we've done the right thing by taking that small step forward for Chetak, which is a big step for big leap for Bajaj Auto. Having said that, yes, the next 1 year, we will make every effort that we can to scale this up. And from there on, we have to then broaden the portfolio, as we did with the Pulsar, and bring in more products and more brands into the EV space. So I don't see ourselves at any disadvantage to anyone else, because, you know, somebody is making 500 a month, somebody is making 1500 a month. You know, everybody's at the same point of the learning curve by and large. So I think that we are neither too early nor too late.
You know, I'm just fascinated with seeing how different companies, different leadership are adapting to this, which is why I wanted to come to the question about, you know, do you think this industry is from here on going to demand a very different style?
No, so I think we will see some big changes associated with this transformation. Number one, you're going to have a whole new set of competitors as an organization, and you're going to have competitors out there who have access to lots of cheap money and who burn it on a daily basis. So how does an incumbent cope with that pressure? You know, each company has to find its answers for that. Number two, as we did with the shift in technology from scooters to motorcycles, once again, we will have to ultimately develop and internalize our own technology. I mean, we can't be buying the entire EV powertrain from suppliers and then hoping to make money selling it. This black box kind of approach is not going to work. That means Bajaj has to develop, as much as it did with the Pulsar, it has to develop its own technology with the Chetak, implement it both in terms of products and process in itself, as also in its supply chain, and implement it to quality and cost. I mean, it took us many years to get the cost structure of the motorcycle right. It's no secret that we lost money for the first several years when we collaborated with Kawasaki, you know, starting mid-80s. Getting the cost structure right and getting the skill sets right, the two assets I talked about earlier, is going to be a second big challenge for the industry. And I think the third is that I anticipate is this, that every time there's a shift in core technology, it is invariably associated with a shift in what people call the form factor, you know, the styling or the design of the vehicle. You know, think of when the Premier Padmini and Hindustan Ambassador gave way to the Maruti 800. It was a very different form factor. The Chetak gave way to a Splendor. a very different form factor. The Splendor gave way to an Activa, a very different form factor. So with the electric vehicle should come very different form factors. It will still ride on two wheels because it's a two-wheeler, but it will be a very different two-wheeler. And we are back to our discussion on being contra-intuitive, because 99 out of 100 marketing people in the country will reject that form factor because they will say it doesn't exist out there. Who's going to buy it? You know, so again, you have to have the conviction that you are standing on the right principles and this is the differentiation which is going to make the impact. So I think these are the kind of issues that existing companies will have to deal with.
What do you think of what Tesla has achieved, Rajiv?
I think Tesla has done remarkably well, and they are not making small numbers anymore. I mean, if what I read is correct, that they made 250,000 vehicles almost in the last quarter. I mean, that's a rate of 1 million vehicles a year. 1 million vehicles a year at that price point puts them right up there with the Germans and Lexus and all the rest of it. So it's outstanding. I don't know how profitable or otherwise they are, but you know.
Last year seems to have been a good one for them.
So that means they've got the secret sauce right.
And when you look at, you know, what you think that company has done correctly?
I think first and foremost, it is this. You know, if you go back to a movie called Sarkar, when the bad guys go to the Swami and say to him that we want to eliminate the Sarkar, the Swami gives a wonderful piece of marketing advice. He says, Sarkar ko marne se pehle, Sarkar ke soch ko marna zaruri hai. You know, because if you destroy the aura around the person, then people don't care about the person. See, what is a brand? The soch, the story is the brand. The human body is the product, you know. So, why I say this is because, why is it that the Nissan Leaf or the Toyota Prius or the Honda whatever or the Chevy Volt or whatever it is, do not have fundamentally the same aura, the same charm as a Tesla? Because when you hear the name Tesla, you know that it occupies the singular position of an electric car. Every Tesla on the road is electric. Can you imagine a hybrid Tesla that also has a petrol and diesel engine in it? I mean, it's sacrilege. It's a sin almost, right? So the thing is that consumers are first and foremost reacting and responding to the brand position. You know, that what a conviction, what a company, what a guy. They are willing to bet everything, on being electric. And of course, they made a fabulous product. You know, that's always important. But engineers rarely fail a company. You know, it's the business guys, the strategic guys, the marketing guys that fail the company most of the time. So I think that the very, very important thing for all of us is going to be how we make a new form factor and a new battery and a new swapping or a new sharing. How do we first create a new perception? Because that is what consumers are looking for. That is what is most charming to them. I don't think the best way is to do a Nissan Leaf, because in the end of the day, a Nissan Leaf is just another Nissan. You know, the same car presented differently. Think of BMW bringing the Mini back. You know, they didn't call it a BMW Mini. They called it a Mini and gave it its own identity, its own personality. I think that is the piece that you have to figure out right. And that is important, because then you're dealing with perhaps a new brand. You have to have an organization that is dedicated to that brand. You have to develop products that reflect or mirror what that brand stands for. You have to develop a distribution network where a consumer can come in and experience that brand in terms of retail experience. Everything will be driven by that. So I think that is what they have got right, in my view.
And that's what you're going to do for Chetak? Or is Chetak just dipping your toes in the water right now?
No, we have to do what we have thought of doing, which is not very dissimilar. We have brought back a brand which has been out of the market 15 years. We have stayed true to that brand. It's an all-metal scooter, because that's what Chetak should be. It's a so-called classic or a modern retro or whatever, because that's what it should be.
But will young audiences connect with it, Rajiv? Chetak is like our parents' generation.
You would be surprised. I mean, ask people. You would be surprised whether it's a Mini or whether it's a Chetak. You know, it is not about what is slick, or what is classic. It is about the charm of having your own position, your own identity. Now, obviously, no brand has 90% market share, so that's not going to happen. But from whatever I have seen, whenever we have researched the Chetak, the appeal is very, very broad. It's quite agnostic to age, gender, and all of that. And that's why we have built a exclusive organization headed by Eric Vaz that deals with the Chetak. We have taken the longer route of not putting the Chetak into the existing 600 Bajaj dealerships. We have put up specific Chetak dealerships. We call them the Chetak Experience Center. So it will be a slow build-up as we did with KTM, because we will be building from scratch the new brand, the new organization, the new distribution. But I think that is what works in the long term, and that seems to have worked for Tesla, from whatever I can observe from the outside.
You'll have to destroy something to build something new, right, Rajiv? 20 years down the line, what is your vision of what you think Bajaj might be?
No, I think I like very much the definition of the job of a CEO that Al Rees wrote about in The Origin of Brands, where he said that the job of the CEO is to find the future in the current activities. So I'm not going to destroy any of the current activities of Bajaj. I have to simply evolve and adapt them to the way the market is moving, or our anticipation of where the market is headed. So, in the past, the Chetak gave way to a Pulsar. Maybe in the future, a Pulsar will give way to a Chetak again. Maybe that is the circle of life, that tells us how to adapt.
Is that too incremental in a transformational space?
No, I don't think so. No? See, on the one hand, we have an existing Bajaj Auto with about a dozen motorcycle brands and about three brands in the three-wheeler quadricycle space. We run a very, very efficient, very profitable organization. Incidentally, the most valuable in the world in its space. So we naturally got to keep this going. So we have to do our best for this, because nobody knows what the future will be. I mean, there are people who will tell you everything will be electric in 5 years, and there are people who will tell you it's not going to happen for 50 years. I will fall back again on the same principle of modularity and say to myself that we will keep ourselves ready to be able to switch from one to the other in whatever mix is required. So while we keep the existing show going, because we can't take the foot off that pedal, we have to at the same time build the future with Chetak and maybe with other electric brands. I mean, it's no secret, we have said that the Chetak platform will be used to build Husqvarna scooters, it will be used to build KTM scooters. In fact, we are also working, with this Bangalore-based company called Yulu, that is today a market leader in micro-mobility. And they are today sourcing out of China, I believe, but tomorrow they will also source out of Bajaj, their requirement of product, which will again come from the Chetak platform. So, I think we are doing quite a lot. Whether it's enough, time will tell.
One last question, Rajiv. Bajaj, on the fact that you quote Jack Trout, you quote the Upanishads, you quote even the Sarkar movie, you talk of homeopathy, you speak of yoga. In this day and age, do you feel that everything you've absorbed about leadership over the last three decades will still be useful to you over the next two decades? Does Rajiv Bajaj himself need to change as he looks at how the marketplace around him is changing and so dramatically?
Well, as someone said, when you're willing to listen, everyone is a teacher. And I frankly found that whether it was homeopathy or yoga, I found that these are very deep sciences. And if they can successfully help a physician to manage somebody's wellness, to improve one's vitality inside out, without any suppression, then perhaps leaning on the same aphorisms by translating them into a management context should work equally well for the organization, and it's worked for me. And as much as yoga continues to evolve, homeopathy continues to evolve, I mean, my homeopath has just sent me day before his latest and newest book. I will read that again, I will learn from that, and hopefully I'll be able to apply something from that. So, as long as I don't know if you remember, you asked me this question 20 years back when we did our first show together for Young Turks, and you said, what is the one thing that you will not leave home without? And I still remember the other guy on the show was Jyotir. Jyotir said what most people would, I think, my mobile phone. And I said to you, I will not leave home without an idea. So as long as you can wake up telling yourself, asking yourself, what's my one idea for making one improvement today? I think you're in a good place.
And you, do you see yourself becoming, I'm going back to an earlier question that you put, where you said that it's going to take a while for you to be able to make it to number one in the domestic market. I'm asking you this as a personal goal, Rajiv. Is this something that you want to see happen in your leadership time?
No, not at all. See, first of all, I have never been fascinated with the number game. For me, it has always been interesting to create the new, to do something different, whether in terms of technology, products, or markets. And, you know, this thing about leadership, I never thought of myself as being the leader, as in the person who does most of the thinking and makes all the decisions and stuff like that. In fact, the quote I like best is that build a team so strong that people can't tell who the leader is. You know, and I think I have a team that is that strong. Otherwise, we would not have a company that is as valuable as it is. And I once asked my homeopath, Dr. Rajan, this question, like I asked him all the difficult questions that that torment my mind. I said, you know, how should leadership be? And he gave me such a beautiful answer. He said, it should be like the flight of the bird across the sky. You know, it's beautiful when it's there, but it goes without a trace. I mean, where is the need to leave behind your stamp, leave behind your identity, leave behind your trail? Not at all. You come, you do your best, and you move on. That is life. That is how it should be.
And that is the perfect note to end this conversation on. You've been very patient with the many questions I've asked you. Or maybe I'll get greedy and I'll ask you one. Do you write this stuff down? Like when you watch Sarkar movie and you see a dialogue, do you put it down and say, okay, you know, the next time somebody asks me this, I'm going to quote it? Because you seem to pull out this incredible variety of references.
Yeah, so I'm still very old-fashioned in that respect. So this is my...
But do you write it down?
My black diary, and it is all written down here. When I'm on a flight, or you know, if I'm just sitting somewhere doing nothing, I will read through it, and I can tell you each thing, because these have come from the masters, you know. So when Guruji Iyengar says structure follows function in the human body, if you have something that is not quite right, start functioning correctly, as in start standing correctly, sitting correctly, twisting correctly, stretching correctly, and your body will align. Now, I am able to translate that to business and say that, you know, by this time talking about organization structure and roles and responsibilities and nonsense stuff like that, you know, the classic HR stuff, start doing the right thing. You want to make the best motorcycle in the world? This is what Shah Rukh told me, for example. He named some world famous director, I've forgotten his name. He said at the end of his book, he wrote this, that if there is one thing I have learned, it is this: we will all make a great movie if we are all making the same movie. You know, so we will all make a great bike if we are making the same bike. And in the process of doing that, I think we will also build a great team. So these are the kind of profound things I have learned from great masters: Jack Trout, Dr. Rajan, Guruji Iyengar, Dr. Wallace, Yamaguchi-san. You know, stuff like that. So I have to keep reading it because it is still taking me many years to understand it.
And it's all in your black book.
It's all in my black diary. And every time the year changes and the diary changes, I write it all again in the new diary. So that is my revision.
Wow. Has anybody offered to publish your diary?
Not yet.
All right then. Rajiv Bajaj, thank you so much. I know we could have discussed profitability and whether this pandemic, you know, will, what the recovery will be like in the months to come. But this has been a much richer conversation for the insight that you've given me in how you approach both the organization, the business, and your own personal management style. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you for making it so. Thanks a lot, Minka.
Thanks.